Good morning and welcome to our morning service, brought to you from the churches of St. John's and St. Andrew's in the parish of Bromsgrove. Please join in with any of the texts that may be in gold bold lettering, and also feel free to join in with the hymn singing wherever you may be. Be assured that wherever you are, we are together in our Lord Jesus Christ. We come from scattered lives to meet with God. Let us recognise his presence with us. We just spent a few moments to reflect on this past week, the roads we have travelled, the people we have met, the presence of God on our walk. As God's people, we have gathered. Let us worship him together. We now sing our first hymn.
Thank you.
We now come to God to say sorry to him for all of our failings, for the ways in which we have withheld love and hope and light. So the grace of God has dawned upon the world with healing for all. Let us come to him in sorrow for our sins, seeking healing and salvation. In a dark and disfigured world, we have not held out the light of life. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. In a hungry and despairing world, we have failed to share our bread. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. In a cold and loveless world, we have kept the love of God to ourselves. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, forgive us our sins and make us holy to serve him in the world, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So as God's forgiven people, we now sing the Gloria. Special prayer for this week. Creator God, you made us all in your image. May we discern you in all that we see and serve you in all that we do. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We now have our New Testament reading.
Today's lesson is taken from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 12 to 25. So don't you see that we don't owe this old do-it-yourself life one red cent? There's nothing in it for us. Nothing at all. The best thing to do is to give it a decent burial and get on with your new life. God's Spirit beckons. There are things to do and places to go. This resurrection life you received from God is not a timid grave-tending life. It's adventurously expectant, greeting God with a childlike, "What's next, Papa?" God's Spirit touches our spirits and confirms who we really are. We know who he is, and we know who we are, Father and children. And we know we're going to get what's coming to us, an unbelievable inheritance. We go through exactly what Christ goes through. If we go through the hard times with him, then we're certainly going to go through the good times with him. And that's why I don't think there's any comparison between the present hard times and the coming good times. The created world itself can hardly wait for what's coming next. everything in creation is being more or less held back. God reins it in until both creation and all the creatures are ready and can be released at the same moment into the glorious times ahead. Meanwhile, the joyful anticipation deepens. All around us we observe a pregnant creation. The difficult times of pain throughout the world are simply birth pangs. But it's not only around us, it's within us, and the Spirit of God is arousing within. We're also feeling the pangs, and these sterile, barren bodies of ours are yearning for full deliverance. And that's why waiting does not diminish us any more than waiting diminishes a pregnant mother. We're enlarged in the waiting. We of course don't see what is enlarging us, but the longer we wait, the larger we become, and the more joyful our expectancy. This is the word of the Lord.
Last week we had the parable of the sower. Today we listen to Jesus telling us the parable of the weeds.
Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. When the wheat sprouted and formed heads, then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, "Sir, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Where then did the weeds come from?" "An enemy did this," he replied. The servants asked him, "Do you want us to go and pull them up?" "No," he answered, "because while you are pulling the weeds, you may uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. At that time I will tell the harvesters, 'First collect the weeds and tie them in bundles to be burned. Then gather the wheat and bring it into my barn.'" His disciples came to him and said, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field." He answered, "The one who sowed the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed stands for the people of the kingdom. The weeds are the people of the evil one, and the enemy who sows them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvesters are angels." As the weeds are pulled up and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will weed out of his kingdom everything that causes sin and all who do evil. They will throw them into the blazing furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Whoever has ears, let them hear.
Good morning. Where did these weeds come from? Who hasn't at some point asked that question? You may not have used those exact words, and you may not have spoken it out loud, but I'll bet nearly everyone has, at some time or another, asked that question. I'm sure also that you've read or watched the news and wondered, how on earth did our world get into this shape? How did we get to this point? It's one bad headline after another. The stabbing of innocent people sitting in a park, the escalation of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict in Gaza, the struggle about refugees coming to live in Britain, the death of people at the hands of those who should be looking after us. It seems the world is going crazy. We often live with the assumption that if we do good, work hard and be nice, everything should be okay. And that's the illusion with which the servants in today's parable live. "Master," they asked the farmer, "did you not sow good seed in your field?" "Of course he did. They know he did. That's why they're so surprised when they discover the weeds. The weeds have shattered their illusion. This isn't supposed to happen." Where did these weeds come from? There is an urgency to their question. They want to know what happened and who is responsible. So do we. That's what we want to know when we discover weeds in our fields. We want an explanation. And someone we can blame, someone we can hold accountable, and even someone to punish. Jesus, however, seems less interested in this approach than we are. He doesn't give it much time or attention. "An enemy has done this," he says. "That's it." He doesn't explain it. He doesn't identify or name the enemy. He doesn't give instructions to find, drive out, and punish this enemy. Behind our desire for an explanation and the name of the culprit is a truth many of us neither like nor want to accept. It's one of the challenges of today's gospel. And the gospel always challenges the way we think, act and live. It's a challenge that arises every time we face the weeds of our life and world. The reality, according to Jesus, is that our lives and our world are a field in which good and evil, life and death, joys and sorrows, that which we want and that which we don't want, grow and live side by side. The wheat and the weeds stand together in our world and in each of our lives. That, Jesus says, is what the kingdom of heaven is like. And that's good news for us. It means that despite the weeds in and around us, the kingdom is still here. The weeds don't overcome or get rid of God's kingdom. It may not be the fullness of the kingdom, but it is, nevertheless, the kingdom. But what about those weeds? What do we do about them? Surely we must do something. Not according to Jesus. "Let them grow together until the harvest," he says. That makes no sense. How can we let them be? The weeds are bad and the wheat is good. We must do something. We need to take a stand, draw a line in the sand, establish some boundaries. Don't you want us to pull up the weeds? The servants asked their master. No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat as well. And these aren't just any old weeds. The parable speaks of a particular weed called the bearded darnel. It's also called false wheat. It grows with the wheat, it looks like wheat. Its roots intertwine with the roots of the real wheat, and the seeds of the bearded darnel are poisonous. The difference between the two is not readily apparent, and it seems that the separation between the wheat and the weeds is not clear-cut. In any event, we are not the ones to make that judgment. We are not the ones to uproot those we see as weeds. Jesus is clear about that. Let them grow until the harvest, he says. Jesus shows more interest in growth than in extermination. He's willing to wait and to be patient. If we are his followers, we too will wait and be patient amongst the weeds of our life. While we wait patiently, let's not get too excited about the end of this parable. Let's not revel in and celebrate the end of the age and the coming of Jesus as some divine weed whacker. I don't think Jesus intended this parable to be taken that way, but rather with absolute seriousness. So do we do nothing? Just sit and wait? No, that's not what Jesus is saying. There's plenty to do, and it will be a challenge. The words that are translated as let them in Jesus' statement, let them grow, can also be translated as forgive them. It's the same word Jesus spoke from the cross when he said, Father, forgive them. Even then on the cross, Jesus is unwilling to pull up the weeds. There's no place in Jesus' gospel for Christian vigilantism, by word or by action, against another or against ourselves. Jesus commands love. Love your enemy, love your neighbour, love yourself, love God. Forgive the weeds? Love the weeds? Remember, the gospel is always a challenge. So yes, forgive them. Yes, love them. Maybe that's how the wheat begins to disentangle its roots from the weeds. Maybe love and forgiveness are what life is like in the mixed field of God's kingdom and this world. God bless you all.
So together with all who participate in this service, we affirm and confirm our common belief and trust in God. Do you believe in God? We believe in God the Father, who made us and the world. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? We believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who came to this earth to rescue us. He died for our sins on the cross, rose from the dead, ascended to the Father in heaven, and will come again in his glory as the judge of all people. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? We believe in the Holy Spirit, whom God gives to all who trust in Christ. The Spirit makes us more like Jesus, guides and strengthens us in our daily life, and helps us to serve God in the family of the Church. May Almighty God strengthen this faith in us. Amen.
I have heard so many songs, listen to a thousand tongues, but there is one that sounds above them all. The Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it over me and for eternity. It's written on my heart. Heaven's perfect melody, the Creator's symphony, you are singing over me. The Father's song. Heaven's perfect mystery, the King of love has sent for me, and now you're singing over me. The Father's song. I have heard so many songs, listened to a thousand tongues, but there is one that sounds above them all. Sounds above them all. The Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it over me and for eternity. It's written on my heart. Heaven's perfect melody, the Creator's symphony, you are singing over me. The Father's song. Heaven's perfect mystery, the King of love has sent for me, and now you're singing over me. The Father's song. King of love has sent for me, and now you're singing over me. The Father's song. The Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it over me and for eternity. It's written on my heart. It's written on my heart. You sing it over me.
We now have a time of silent prayer. And in the silence, I invite you not just to pray for the burdens and concerns that you carry, but to remember the needs of the world, for those in authority, for those whom we depend on. While we pray, there will be some quiet music playing in the background. Thank you. As our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen. We now share the peace with those immediately around us and with the world. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then they were glad when they saw the Lord. Hallelujah. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. Let's just share a sign of peace with those immediately around us, and for those who are close to our hearts. We now offer peace to the world. Can I invite you just to lift your hands towards a window, and together we will say, "May the peace of God fill the hearts of all and calm our fears." We now sing our final hymn.
To God, whose word was spoken in the deed that made the earth, is the voice that called a nation, is the fires that tried its worth. God has spoken, God has spoken. Praise Him for His open word. Thanks to God, whose word is published in the tongues of every race. See its glory undiminished by the change of time or place. God has spoken, God has spoken. Praise Him for His open word. Thank you. was answered by the Spirit's voice within. Here we drink of joy unmeasured, life redeemed from death and sin. God has spoken, God has spoken, praise Him for His open word. Thanks to God whose word was spoken in the deep that made the earth. Here's the voice that called a nation. Here's the fires that tried its worth. God has spoken, God has spoken. Praise Him for His open word.
And a final blessing. Through the tender compassion of our God, may the dawn from on high break upon you and guide your feet into the way of peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. To a troubled world, peace from Christ. To a searching world, love from Christ. To a waiting world, hope from Christ.